Today on Let Them Talk TV, we embark on a tour through the United Kingdom, exploring 10 British cities, each with its own unique and charming accent. We'll take a deep dive into the phonetics and the history of the accents and how they are all connected through invasion and migration over the centuries. And joining me on this linguistic journey, I'm delighted to have with me today accent coach and YouTuber Luke. Hello, Luke.
Hello, thanks for inviting me on to Let Them Talk TV.
You're welcome. So firstly, maybe you could quickly introduce yourself.
Hi, my name's Luke Nicholson. I'm an accent coach based in London in the United Kingdom. I teach English learners how to communicate more clearly and confidently. I've taught speakers from 90 countries around the world. I also lecture at the Summer School in English Phonetics at UCL. And I'm a phonetics enthusiast.
For each city, we will look at the history of the accent, then we'll listen to a famous person from the city, and then Luke will analyze the speaker and delve into the phonetics of the accent. By the end of this video, you'll know how to speak in four different northern accents. And we're going to start with Newcastle.
Right, you've had your phone. Now, how are you?
The castle in Newcastle that gave the town its name isn't so new. It was built by William the Conqueror in 1080. Today, Newcastle is part of Tyne and Wear, but historically, the Newcastle area would have been part of the Kingdom of Northumbria. Northumbria means north of the River Humber. The Northumbrian Kingdom covered areas that include parts of present-day Scotland. There are many layers to the Newcastle accent, which is known as Geordie. From the 5th to the 10th centuries, Northumbria was part of a kingdom of the tribe known as the Angles, who came from an area in present-day Denmark. So in Northumbria, they spoke the Anglian dialect of Old English, which was similar but different from the Saxon dialect. Just to give you one example, in West Saxon, they would have said church. But in Old Northumbrian and in modern-day Scots, they say kirk. In modern Geordie, there are still words that have their origin in the Old English of the Angles, such as the word war for our or my. So warlass means my wife or my girlfriend in Geordie.
If you wouldn't mind, warlass.
And ben from Old Anglian English bean, meaning a child. You'll also hear that in Scotland. The Angles gave us the name England. Old Northumbrian continued to be spoken in Scotland and developed into the Scots language, still spoken today. In England, they don't speak the Scots language, but in Old Northumbrian, it shares a common ancestor with Geordie. In the mid-9th century, the Vikings invaded, but they only settled south of the River Tees, so their influence on the dialect would have been less pronounced, literally, than that in Yorkshire, whose accent was heavily influenced by Vikings, as we shall see later. The Great Vowel Shift was a historical, phonological change in Middle English, altering English vowel pronunciations between 1400 and 1700, approximately. Although it affected all dialects of English, it was felt more strongly in the south of England than the north. So quite a lot of vowel sounds in Newcastle and other areas of the north of England preserve earlier vowel sounds. So for example, in most of the north of England, you'll hear people say storn, not stone, as I do in my southern accent, and norn, not known, as I say it. And the Geordie accent we'll be discussing is that of comedian Ross Noble.
She looks like an angel. I mean, metaphorically, obviously. I don't mean she walks around in the nude playing a harp. I've asked her, she won't.
And it ended up becoming five newspapers picked up on the MP one, and then all of a sudden, and I knew it sort of got a bit out of control when I opened up, obviously you know, getting popular here and then going over to Australia.
You'll notice that the vowel sound in open and no is very different to the vowel sound in my accent. I use an O vowel, a diphthong here, open, no, whereas he is using more of an or type vowel.
When I opened up, you know, when I opened up, you know.
That's one big difference between Newcastle and my accent, and my accent is standard Southern British English. In the word newspaper, the second P, I would pronounce it as a P sound, but in Newcastle, it's pronounced with some glottalization, some creaky voice. So rather than a P sound, it's more of a B type sound. Rather than newspaper, it's something like newspaper, but at the end. So it's a slightly different type of P, which is typical of Geordie. I know my pronunciation is terrible, but take a look at some more Geordie clips and you'll hear it.
Five newspapers.
In his pronunciation of up and becoming, those vowels are in up, becoming, are not like my accents in the south, it's an U vowel. So if you listen to the clip, you'll hear a U type vowel for those two words.
And it ended up becoming.
And that's because in England, we have a difference between words in the foot lexical set and words in the strut lexical set. This means that the verb to put something on the table is pronounced differently to putt in golfing, putt. But in certain parts of the Midlands and the north of England, there's no distinction between these two vowels, these two categories. They are part of the same category. And so that's why he's pronouncing these vowels with an U-type vowel.
The Angles, they came from what is now parts of Denmark and parts of northern Germany. And I believe there's still some dialect words in Newcastle and Northumbria, like Ben for child. So maybe, I don't know, maybe can we hear a bit of Danish or German in the Newcastle accent? Do you notice it?
Certainly you'll find lighter L sounds in Newcastle compared to other parts of the UK. If we take the word level, for me I have a light L at the beginning of level and a dark L at the end, level. But speakers in Newcastle and speakers in Germany when they speak English, and in Denmark I think, will use light L's. So rather than level, it would be something like level, level. Mm. Level. And so that might remind you of Germanic origins. Whether it is exactly from that source, I don't know, because it's been many, many years, of course, since they came into the British Isles. And so perhaps these unusual intonation patterns, well, not unusual, but unfamiliar intonation patterns that you hear in Newcastle, maybe that will also remind you of Scandinavian intonation patterns.
You can say how to mean come on.
Yeah, it doesn't mean
how to mean to mean
no
come off it.
Yeah. So it's either come on or come off. So you would say, how are the lads?
Which
means come on the lads. Or you'd say to someone, oh how are you, man, which means come away man. Get off of it man.
Should we go?
Yes.
How are
Leeds. Leeds, in the county of West Yorkshire, is one of the largest cities in the UK with a population of around 800,000. The name derives from Celtic and means something like people of the fast-flowing river. Carbonated water was invented in Leeds in 1767, and the first film ever, The Roundhay Garden Scene, was shot here in 1888. There are many layers of the Yorkshire accent. From the middle of the 5th century, the area around Leeds was ruled by the Angles. Then the Vikings from Scandinavia invaded and the region became part of the Danelaw. Here is a map of the Danelaw in 878. The Vikings spoke a language called Old Norse, which was similar but different from Anglo-Saxon or Old English. Both languages would have been spoken in the same region. English is greatly influenced by the Viking language. About 5% of English words come from Old Norse, including very common ones such as they, are, knife, and sister. Some words in the Yorkshire dialect have Scandinavian roots, such as leg, meaning to play. Compare it to modern Norwegian, leke. For example, are you leking today or are you working? Eop, meaning hello, is from Scandinavian origin. Compare it to Swedish, seop, meaning watch out.
Oh, here we go, speak of the devil.
Lugol means your ears. Compare it to Norwegian, lugge, which means pull by the hair. Here is a clip of a short film shot entirely in Old Norse. Of course, it's a long, long way from the modern day accent of Leeds, but it's just to give you a flavour of how they used to speak there 1,000 years ago.
Aldregi vil der hetta delt oss. Aldregi. Hetta en beste kostur. Sigrumskven og gormi og liti hans. To verder så unga dengo. Ver jotum at bjerga bønum vorm. Sidan kommer med fara.
Vid Odin, to jotum ver at bergask.
Now we're going to listen to a clip of Mel B, just to let you know that she's speaking on a very serious topic of domestic abuse. But what she says is really interesting, and I'll let Luke have a dive into her accent.
It's completely turned upside down, because if you've been, whether you've been in an abusive relationship for an hour, a day, a month, a year, 10 years, there's things that the abuser does to you that will never leave you, from literally telling you everything that's wrong with you, putting you in certain situations where you feel so humiliated.
Luke, over to you.
You can hear that the A vowel in Mel B's accent here, it's a monophthong, it's just an air vowel. You can hear it in the word day as dare, and relationship as relationship.
A day, relationship, relationship.
So it's a monophthong, air. You can also hear a darker L in all contexts. So the way that she says leave, for instance, has that darker L at the beginning. But in my accent, it's more of a L sound. Leave rather than leave.
We'll never leave you. Leave you.
Like other accents in the north of England, there's no foot strut split. So the way that she says month isn't with an a vowel like in my accent, but with more of an u vowel. Month rather than month.
A month, a month.
That foot strut split, can you sort of draw a line somewhere across England where those vowel sounds merge?
Yeah, it's kind of from the Midlands upwards into the north of England. So Notts has that distinction, as does southern England, but in the Midlands and the north, it's either the same or it's variable. So it depends on the speaker.
Okay. I lived in Leeds as well. I went to university in Leeds. So sometimes it was difficult to understand people, especially at the beginning when I moved up there. And people would say, I'm going to pub or something like that. And they would leave out the definite article. I don't know if that's a feature, is it? I think that's why.
So it would be using a glottal stop instead. So the word to, pronounced in the weak form, to, and then putting a glottal stop for the word the, to. It's not perhaps deleted, but it's replaced with a glottal stop. So that's what's signifying this definite article.
There's a, I don't know if you can hear the police car.
French police cars.
The riot's kicking off now, but I don't know. While doing research for this video, I was watching a film called Kez. I don't know if you've seen it. There's a book about a kid growing up in Leeds, and he decides to have a kestrel. But the kids were talking and they were using thou and thee. It's curious that even until the 1960s, people were using thee. And I don't think that was the case in many other parts of England or Scotland. I think it already died out sometime in the 18th or 19th century.
Shut him off.
Come and met me.
I won't say that to our Judy'd murder thee.
You're just now.
Well, he's got a estate, that's all.
I bet I know somebody who could do him.
Who, the father?
What is still used are second person plural pronouns. So in my variety of English, I just say you, and we don't know if it's just one person or multiple people, whereas in some dialects around the UK, you can use ye or use, and it's referring to more than one person.
My accent was not exactly the same as yours, but I would use you for both singular and plural, and if I really wanted to make it clear that it was a plural, I would add another word, you guys, you lot. Yes. We're moving west across the Pennines now to Manchester. The foundations of the accent were laid between the 6th and 10th centuries when the Anglo-Saxon kingdoms of Northumbria, Mercia and Wessex vied for control over northwest England. In present-day Greater Manchester, there are a diverse number of accents, and the differences between the accents of Manchester and the surrounding area of Lancashire can be traced back to its industrial past. Manchester was the birthplace of the Industrial Revolution. Manchester used to be a small market town. In the early 18th century, it had a population of around 10,000, but by the start of the 20th century, it had grown to around 700,000. During the Industrial Revolution, the population grew rapidly as people moved from other parts of the British Isles into the city seeking new opportunities. Particularly large numbers came from Ireland, especially after the Great Famine of the 1840s. In 1851, it was estimated that 15% of the population of Manchester were Irish-born. Manchester was a major centre of the cotton industry during the Industrial Revolution. The rapid urbanisation and migration of people that came to work in the city's factories and mills led to a melting pot of accents and dialects. This mixing of linguistic backgrounds contributed to the development of the distinct Manchester accent, known as Mancunian. The opening of the Manchester Ship Canal brought in many immigrants from overseas, including Eastern Europe, Italians, Scandinavians, and many more. After the Second World War, waves of immigrants from former colonies, such as from the Indian subcontinent and the Caribbean. Manchester is said to be the most linguistically diverse city in the UK after London.
So the Manchester accent has been voted the sexiest in the UK. Over half the people polled in a recent survey said they thought that the Mancunian accent was the sexiest, and also it indicated that people were more intelligent and trustworthy. And in love, the
sun shines out of our behind. You're not a fan of 80s indie music?
Yes. But I suppose I haven't been as exposed to it as forms of music. Maybe.
Yeah, I lived through it.
In the 80s.
Well, yeah, I was greatly influenced by the Smiths at the time. So maybe that's why I chose this clip of Morrissey. Let's have a listen.
Watch television and done all the things that in life are generally considered to be quite negative and quite soul-destroying. The only way that I could find any mental relaxation is to simply go out and walk. And to walk around these streets, which can seem quite depressing to most people and seem quite laughably simplistic, but for me it was perfect fuel.
So over to you.
We talked about the foot strut split that's in the south of England but not in the north. Well, here we've got another split, which is the trap bath split. So in my accent there's a difference between words like trap, bath. They have different vowel sounds. But in other accents, for example, in Northern England, they have the same vowel, so trap and bath. And in the clip, you can hear him say laughably as laughably. So laugh belongs to the bath lexical set for me. It has that R, that long back vowel. But in his accent, it has the same vowel as trap, laughably.
Seem quite laughably simplistic.
He is noticeably Manchester, but Phil, is his accent a little less pronounced than other Mancunians?
Yes, I wouldn't say he has a very strong Mancunian accent at all. The way he pronounces the word walk, he pronounces it with a more open vowel sound, so more like walk. So that open R is fairly typical of Manchester.
You go out and walk, you go out and walk.
But otherwise, there are lots of features of his accent that definitely sound more southern, and that's probably because he's travelled, he's speaking to lots of different people, he perhaps identifies with different areas of the country, not just Manchester.
But he definitely sounds like he's from the north, from that
there are definite features of his accent that are simply not what I wouldn't associate with Mancunian. Okay. And would place him elsewhere, which is why when people say, guess my accent, sometimes it's quite tricky. You can't place it in one geographical location because there are features that come from different areas. Quite stereotypical features of Mancunian accents are the final vowels of words like happy, funny, and sometimes Morrissey is using an E vowel, which you would definitely associate with the South or Newcastle.
Okay. But so the North is more happy or something like that. Okay.
Yeah, exactly. Then that NG sound, for example, in thing and along, lots of Mancunian speakers will pronounce that final G at the end. Mm-hmm. So thing, along, rather than thing, along.
In all the major cities, I mean, there are a variety of accents, aren't there?
Yeah, so. And there'll be features that are shared by multiple cities that might not be related. They're just simply by chance, and other things that maybe are related.
Okay, and Morris is also unique. So
yes, there's that features. As well. Of course, there are different Manchester accents, and what I consider a stereotypical Mancunian accent isn't the one true one. It's just one of many. And you're treading on tricky ground when you're saying he doesn't sound Mancunian because if he grew up there, well, then he clearly is. And you're somehow taking part of his identity if you say he doesn't sound like he's from that place. Yeah. So I don't want to do that. I just want to say that features of his accent don't necessarily place him geographically in Manchester.
The Manchester, you know, I'm born and bred in Manchester, and I find the Manchester accent more funny more than anything, but not sexy.
Now we move 35 miles west to Liverpool. After the Romans left Britain in the 5th century, the area around Liverpool was occupied by various Anglo-Saxon tribes and eventually became part of the Kingdom of Mercia. In the early 10th century, Vikings from Norway, rather than the Danes that we discussed in some of the other accents we've looked at so far, settled in West Lancashire and formed a kind of mini Viking state. There are lots of place names in the Liverpool area that attest to its Viking past, such as Crosby and Kirby, by meaning a settlement in Old Norse, and Toxteth and Croxteth, the ETH, earth, meaning a homestead. The accent from Liverpool is called Liverpudlian, or Scouse. Why Scouse? It comes from lobscouse, which is a popular dish eaten by sailors and is Scandinavian in origin, possibly Viking. Liverpool was founded as a town by King John in 1207. However, it only consisted of 7 streets at that time. Before 1830, the accent in Liverpool would have been quite similar to the dialect spoken in the rest of Lancashire. Nowadays, the accent of Liverpool is quite distinct from those of nearby cities such as Manchester, which is only about 30 miles away. Liverpool was another town that grew rapidly during the Industrial Revolution. In the early 18th century, its population was around 5,000. By the beginning of the 20th century, it had reached around 700,000. Liverpool is a dock, so it's always been connected to the outside world by sea. During the 19th century, mass migration from Ireland as well as nearby Wales led to the dialect of the city to change radically. In addition, the accents of other migrants who made their home in Liverpool merged to create the unique Scouse sound. Slang you might hear in Liverpool, scran, meaning food. The word is actually from Old Norse and originally meant rubbish. Scran is also used in Manchester and Newcastle and Glasgow. A guy can be a la, and the police are called the bizzies. The clip you can hear is of Judy Comer.
More the languages, I wrote them out as they sounded, which was seemed like the easiest way to learn them. But I had an amazing voice coach who, you know, kept me in line. And also when we filmed in Tuscany and I was doing the Italian, I just said to the crew, I was like, please, if I'm not doing this any justice, please just give me a little tap on the shoulder. So they did.
What's interesting is the way that she pronounces the word learn. So in my accent, there's a distinction between the words fair, as in it's just, it's right, it's fair, and fur, as in a fur coat. fair and fur. But speakers in Liverpool might not make this distinction. They might pronounce it as the same vowel sound. And that vowel quality might be closer to air, or it might be closer to it depends on the speaker. But you can hear how she's saying learn rather than learn, as it would be in my accent. Again, we've got no distinction between foot and strut. So the way she says Tuscany and justice is actually with an vowel, Tuscany and justice. So it has this foot vowel. There's no distinction between foot and strut.
London, Tuscany, justice.
Now there are plenty of other features that make the Scouse accent, the accent from Liverpool, very unique. These aren't necessarily in the clip, but you'll hear speakers pronounce syllable final K, a K sound, as more of a H sound. So something like clock with a K at the end might be something like cloch, cloch, with that fricative rather than the plosive K.
That's how I can distinguish the Liverpool accent. But is that the only place in Britain where you hear the H sound, or...
Well, if we're talking about that sound in general, then you'll hear it in Scotland in words like loch, although the sound I made in cloch was actually made further back, but regardless, it's that similar fricative sound made at the back of the mouth. But otherwise, turning syllable final k into h, I don't think so. I think it's just in that area.
It's a funny old thing, Mama, isn't it, life? Aveline and Julie have left the fold. Dad's on his way back, back.
You'll hear people say things like carry rather than carry, so that R has become that tapped R. And then Liverpool has this quality to, well, all accents have a certain quality that runs throughout the voice. And Liverpool has, or Scouse accents have, velarization, which means that the back of the tongue is raised slightly towards the velum, the soft palate, throughout speech in general. And this gives it this kind of darker, slightly nasal, perhaps, quality that we associate with Scouse accents.
Are there any other features of a Liverpool accent that we might hear that wasn't in the clip?
Yes, well, sometimes T's turn into glottal stops, and that happens throughout the UK, but sometimes they get just deleted. So rather than it with a T at the end or it with a glottal stop at the end, you might just hear eh, eh. So that T has been deleted or has been turned into a an H-type sound. Also, something that's specific to Liverpool, but also the surrounding area, is when you have a word spelled with two O's followed by a K. So in the word cookbook, for instance, I have an U vowel in both cookbook, but you might hear an U vowel. So something like kuchbuch, and you'll hear kuchbuch in other accents in the north of England. Many people say that you can hear lots of influence of Irish English in Liverpudlian. I should say Liverpudlian or Scouse. Those are adjectives that we use for these accents. One similarity you might hear is the way that T is pronounced. So T can be pronounced in different ways, but if it's not pronounced as a glottal stop, then it might be pronounced affricated, assimilated, so with a lot of S-type sound to it. For example, in the word better, better, you can hear that I'm releasing my tongue from the T really slowly, which allows a lot of friction to come out. And that sounds a bit like an S after the T, better, better. And you'll hear that same type of sound in Irish English. Obviously, there's a lot of different Irish accents, but in particular, well, a lot of Irish accents, you'll hear something like better, better. And so that T sounds very S-like. Quite interesting is that parts of Lancashire were very heavily rhotic, so every R would have been pronounced. which we don't really associate with Lancashire, with Northern English. We associate that with West Country English or other Englishes in Scotland, in Ireland, in America. So Liverpool is obviously in this area, which has been Rhotic until very recently, and yet has had so much Irish immigration, and Irish English is Rhotic. So it's interesting that it's non-Rhotic in Liverpool. But I think probably it was Rhotic until very recently as well. Mm-hmm. But yes, nowadays in Liverpool, it's, I think, all non-Rhotic. Maybe there's a few old speakers who are Rhotic, but yeah.
Octogenarian Liverpudlians.
Yes.
Yeah. What's this?
It's an ad.
No, what is it?
Oh, it's no good, sir. I just can't lie. I'm programmed always to tell the truth.
It's easy. Look, an orange, a melon, a female aardvark.
Thank you for watching part one. Do check out the other videos in the series. And if you're interested in English accents and the history of the English language, then sign up for our newsletter, link in the description. Bye.